A very good evening to all. I'm Atul Kamath. I welcome you all to CAMS Cyber Security Workshop. I hereby request Mr. Anuj Kumar, CEO CAMS, to extend the welcome address.
Thanks, Atul. Good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for sparing your time, especially after a busy day, to be here. It's my privilege to welcome all our guests from the asset management companies, our keynote speaker, our industry expert, our members of the panel, and all my colleagues from CAMS, some of whom are based in Mumbai, some of whom flew down from Chennai to be here for this event. We will talk to you about the schedule of this cybersecurity symposium. But essentially, given the fact that cyber and web security, IT security, information privacy are becoming such core topics, they are not in the realm of specialized agenda that only our IT friends and colleagues deal with. But these are topics that each one of us is dealing with day on day. And given the fact that our regulator SEBI had put out a framework back in the fourth quarter of last year in terms of seeking compliance of the QRTAs to a particular framework, we thought that this is the right time to get together and update each one of you on what we have done, and also to make sure that we have a stimulating contemporary discussion amongst the panel members and the addresses from the industry experts, which I'm sure will be enlightening and will be of relevance to each one of us. Very happy to have Mr. C.N. Ram amongst us. He will be setting the context for today's event. C.N. Ram, I'm sure most of you know, but those who don't, was part of the founding team of HDFC Bank, was the CTO for the bank for a long period of time, and now in a consulting capacity, works with various organizations in India and overseas to drive the IT agenda for organizations, so help them drive their IT agenda, and cybersecurity is a topic which is very close to him. Vinay Godse, who's consented to be the keynote speaker. Lalit Popli, who works for ICICI Pru MF and will be demonstrating certain key aspects of this topic to you. And Karthik Shinde, MV Shashadri, and Samir Shah, who will participate in the panel. So I thank each one of you gentlemen for having taken the time out and to extend the sense of partnership that you've extended to us as a company and to the wider community here in our collective interests. At CAMS, given the importance of this topic, we have broken the boundaries of how we think in a way and taken the frontier of understanding things about architecture, data privacy and security, not just to the world of mutual funds and capital markets, but outside. And therefore, our expert group has people who've deep and varied experience in various other kind of financial institutions, but especially banks, stock exchanges, and other parts of the capital market. So to that extent, we are kind of livening this up through views, experiences, which are not just native to the world of mutual funds, but kind of straddle that boundary and go across. Why is cybersecurity attracting so much attention? I think the topic is, and its relevance is clear to all of us. As organizations, each one of us is pushing up the digital agenda. We are creating means for our customers, investors, clients to access our various properties almost seamlessly through various means, through various devices, through various networks at all times of the day in the format that they require. And we are all trying to make it easier and easier and easier, which means that the balance between creating a process which is tough to operate but is not friendly to customers, to creating a process which is very friendly to customers but in the end does things sometimes so fast and makes it so easy that for a customer to understand whether his credentials, his login ID password, his the assets and properties that he controls Are they ever going to be accessed by someone else? And we keep hearing about credit card cloning. We know about what happens to cell phones on a cellular network and how easy it is to hack some of those things. So the balance of creating a deep and intense digital access strategy and making sure that that is secure is consuming organizations like ourselves and all the asset managers here find this topic of great relevance. And the topic of cybersecurity is getting out of the IT backroom. I think there was a time when it belonged to the IT backroom, it belonged to the IT strategy. But today it's at the core and crux of business. I am personally engaged with the topic. I like to update myself very frequently. And to be able to engage with the topic, not just through an intellectual way, but also to make sure that the maverick, non-orthodox styles that some of the intruders will adopt and they continue to adopt, which are not written about in books, which are not written about in research papers, but which are out there practically for us to encounter, are known to us, are known to our people, that our people understand that a small slip up, either at the design phase or at the execution phase of any of these steps, can be extremely expensive, and losses can be irretrievable, because while we believe that all of them leave logs and traces, there are ways to make sure that logs and traces are not available. As a company, therefore, even before the regulatory framework kicked in, the leadership team had taken a lot of initiative to make sure that we are driving this point and agenda culturally and not just operationally, and I'm very happy to kind of share with you the detailed work that has been done in CAMS over the last 12 months. We have been sending most of you updates, so you know how we are treating this topic. But as we progress today, we would like to give you more and more details on this. Like I said, at the grassroots level, inside the organization, we are building awareness. And not just in our staff, but across our entire ecosystem of vendors, providers, prospective employees, up and down the hierarchy pyramid that we have, to understand the importance of the topic. Creating dedicated data protection, ethical hacking teams, and making sure they're contemporary, and they're not stuck in time in terms of knowing stuff that they learned a few years back. What they learned a few years back may not be of great relevance today. Making sure that we have readiness in terms of incidence response, that this is done 24/7. And despite the fact that we may take comfort out of the fact that we have multiple backups, multiple sites, a BCPDR plan that we continue to test often, latency in terms of backing up data, etc. We also know that anybody who wants to tinker with the system will know each of these things and will sometimes know the stuff we don't want him to know, and which is why also some of this plan we are keeping in a way so that apart from a few people inside the organization, it is not really revealed in terms of nuts and bolts to everyone across. Investment in technology, not just buying high-end servers or high-end firewalls, but making sure that each part of the architecture conforms to the needs of the day. And then making sure that we have high levels of governance, because it is easy to start a topic like this and start talking about it and make it contemporary and fashionable. It is tough to make sure that this has the eyes of the management and this is governed adequately week on week, month on month, quarter on quarter, so that if we have an incident, then we are able to react to it, we are not caught unawares, and everything is pointing in the right direction in order to fight the incidents. The details on the entire plan will be shared by Ramki when he comes on stage. But I would thank each one of you again. I hope this session is relevant for you, that you take away a lot more of hard, granular information about our readiness, that you learn a thing or two from the very distinguished panel that we have with us today, and that you enjoy the session. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anuj. So while Anuj touched upon this vulnerability that we have on cybersecurity and other aspects, and how we are going to treat it across. So taking the session ahead, there is a context setting for today's cybersecurity workshop, which will be presented by Mr. C.N. Ram. It is my pleasure to introduce Mr. C.N. Ram. So, Mr. Ram was a Chief Information Officer and Head of Information Technology for HDFC Bank Limited since July 94 till 2008, and was responsible for its IT activities as well as its subsidiaries. Mr. Ram was a member of Global Customer Advisory Board of NCR Corporation for the self-service business, the Asia-Pacific Technology Advisory Board for Visa International, and the Customer Executive Advisory Board for Sun Microsystems. He was also a member of Reserve Bank of India IT Advisory Committee. Served as an advisor to the National Depositories Limited and NPCI. Mr. Ram was first recipient of the Conrad Zuse Medal of Honor for Lifetime Achievement in Business Technology instituted by CIO Association of India in 2013. Presently, he is associated with Warburg Pincus India Private Limited as senior advisor since 2015. I request Mr. Ram to come on stage and set the context for the workshop.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Firstly, thanks Anuj and Kams for having me here. It's been a long time since I spoke publicly, so thanks for reintroducing me to the public. I also have to compliment them on their management of the weather god. And in ample preparation, they actually had a dry day yesterday as well. I don't know how they accomplished it. But when you put your mind to it, I guess anything is possible. So from a context setting perspective on cybersecurity, I know there are a lot of distinguished people after me who are going to talk about various technologies, things which you should think about while you're thinking about your own security strategy, what people have done, what people haven't done, etc., etc. So I'll keep it very simple. I'd like to think of information security, and my sympathies always lie with the technology folks, you know, because of my background. I wish, in the present context, we were like the BMC. Some people will call them BCMC, but you know, that's a different matter. This is one of total negligence, but at the same time, totally oblivious to what their responsibilities are, and in complete denial. If you can get away with it by saying what rain, what potholes, what deaths, we don't know anything, and it's gone all the way up to the minister, so it seems like a contagion. Now, if IT guys can actually get away by saying what security gaps, who breached us, did anyone lose money when that happens? I think we may have to start hiring people from the BMC, because it seems like a very nice training ground. The real problem with IT security is our own attitude, and that's the only thing that I'm going to talk about from a context setting. Traditionally, we have been very blasé about security, and even today, with all the awareness about what can go wrong, people still post on Facebook, and you've heard studies in the UK talking about how most of the robberies get planned, you know, in conjunction with, not with Facebook, but what you post on Facebook, right? So where you were, what kind of stuff you bought, where you are today. So my home is all available, except leaving the key in the front door, you've done everything possible to announce that the place is up for robbery. When you send, for instance, I don't know how many of you have applied for visas to go abroad, especially Schengen. I mean, they want everything from you, right? So you take bank statements which have everything, including your name and address. There are some banks which are very sensitive and they start masking the address and relevant portions of your account information. So even if it, you know, even after the visa is granted, I don't know what the embassies do with it. If they just give it to the Raddiwala, it still doesn't have all the information that is needed to reset your password, hijack all your credentials, and do something sinister with your account. This is the environment we live in. We are very freely giving away data, and when banks send you statements, it is encrypted on PDF. And what is the password? Your name and last four digits of your account. And do you think people don't know when you were born, what is your name? So I'm not sure who they are kidding. Attitudes within the organization are also very similar. It is always somebody else's problem. And usually it is the hapless IT guy who has to sit and explain why we were breached or why our fundamentals were not strong enough. When they come with proposals, the senior people say, "What business justification do you have?" Okay, there is some risk for the brand. What happens if the newspapers announce that you have been breached and customer data is out in the open? That's when people start taking notice. So many of the IT guys have relegated themselves to praying that this thing will not happen. And when it does happen, they'll get the funding that is required to actually secure the organization. So many of us in this room are probably influential people who can actually influence the direction of security, and somehow we need to get away from this very blasé, chalta hai kind of attitude. That is going to be the significant change that is going to affect a whole lot of security in the organization. I think Anuj alluded to it, we can actually bind ourselves in security and make it so difficult to deal with us. And that's usually the problem that most financial institutions have, that how do you balance this delicate thing of how tough do you make it for somebody, I mean, changing passwords every 30 days or 90 days, generating a password which has not been used the last 10 times. All of us have our favorite passwords, right? Unless you've stumbled on a good password manager. And then some of the sites don't allow password managers to actually auto-populate the password. So there is an inconsistency in terms of how we deal with this kind of friction, which we don't want. You want more and more people to go online, more and more people to do self-service, but at the same time, we are concerned about what is going to be the effect of security or the lack of it when it does get exposed. Many of us don't have a response team or a response SOP which says, believe you me, all of us will get breached some point in time or the other, despite your best efforts. But what's our SOP? What is our response to the external situation? How do you allay any fears about a widespread security breach in your organization, which may lead to customers actually taking their business elsewhere? We need to actually think about all these kind of things. We need to have SOPs, we need to have response, and we need to make sure that only the responsible people are talking to people who disseminate news. Now you know how fake news gets around. All it needs is, especially for banks, all it needs is just one murmur and there'll be a run on the bank. People will be queued up in front of the ATMs. And normal cash outs will be construed as, you know, disaster events. And they'll say, this bank doesn't have cash, you're finished. So, I don't want to paint a doomsday scenario, but our own attitude towards security is not as stringent as it should be. And we don't support our IT people as much as we should. Because if you start asking for business justifications in terms of simple things, like how do you actually protect yourself, then there is something fundamentally which is wrong. Another thing which happens is that we are also not looking at the, I'll give you a small example, my own example. Last year, my house got burgled. We live in a flat, like most of us in Mumbai, and we thought everything was secure because we had watchmen, you know, round the clock. The guys were sleeping. And we used to see them sleeping, but we thought the mere presence of somebody hurly-burly out there would deter the robbers. Obviously not. So the guy climbed onto the first floor, burgled the place, climbed onto the second floor, which is mine. Luckily, he had exhausted himself, I think, climbing all those floors. So he just took my office laptop and went away. And you know what? He left my wallet with my credit cards. He took the money, but he actually left the credit cards because he said, what use of credit cards? I'm going to complain and have them blocked anyway. So he didn't even bother to take it. So immediate response was, oh my God, we are vulnerable. So we put grills, we put a security system. And then when I started to think about it, I said, I mean, this is not the root cause of the problem. The root cause is that the deterrent, which is supposed to be the people lying outside, instead of sleeping, if they were wandering around and making sure that everybody saw them while they were doing their rounds. So we fixed the problem by making sure that those guys cannot sleep by having an, you know, the bio attendance system installed where every 15 minutes he has to go to a different floor in the building and actually you know, use his fingerprint to say that he's alive and he's awake. My security system has not been armed at all. So it's just lying out there with all the bells and whistles, but it's there. So very often, in our anxiety to do things, we overdo things, and these are probably not very appropriate. The good thing about technology these days is that a lot of people are thinking about security, and they understand that the people who are trying to actually intrude into your system are a lot smarter. Earlier, it used to be the thrill of conquest, you know, go to your website, deface it, put a flag and say, hey, I've been here and what can you do to prevent me? Now, it's all very subterranean. People are lurking, they're just fishing all the data and using it till it actually becomes an avalanche, you don't even notice. So what you need are preventing technologies which are smarter than all of these put together. So there are AI-based, machine learning-based intrusion detection systems. So just putting a firewall and misconfiguring it will not do. Just having an antivirus will not do. Making sure that the versions are current is not enough. So you need a massive threat protection. More importantly, detection of what is normal, not what is out of the ordinary, and being able to detect it in time to prevent a disaster from happening. We had the WannaCry, right? So people very easily sent out messages saying, do not click on any attachments from suspicious mail. They didn't define what suspicious meant.